Hollywood and pop culture is known for the big lights, celebrities, and limelight. But Alan Mruvka is the embodiment of a multifaceted mogul. Before social media impacted society's social climate, Alan created the first ever 24-hour celebrity-obsessed news station in America. Alan is a co-founder and creator of E! Entertainment Television. He is now moving into bigger and new ventures in his storage brand business. In today's episode, Alan will share with us his inspirational story and how he became the successful person he is today. Welcome to my show, Alan.
Thank you. Thanks so much, James, for having me.
I'm looking forward to this. I was telling my friends about this before, and I think now E! Entertainment Television has been out for, what, 34 years now in 1987?
It launched in 1987, yes.
That's crazy. Because I remember when it came out on TV, I was like, what is this? And of course, I was instantly drawn to it because that's the type of person I am. But how did you even come up with this, that concept?
You know, I've had film and television in my blood since I was literally 5 years old.
Oh, wow.
I used to, living in Queens, New York, as a five-year-old, I would watch a lot of television. I always say when my mother wanted me to take a bath, she'd have to wheel in an old TV into the bathroom.
And that's hysterical.
I'd sit in the tub for a sitcom and then get out. So I was addicted to movies and television since I was a little kid. Yeah. In fact, back then they had on the local channel, Channel 11, they had... a movie of the week, and they would show the same movie every night the whole week, and I watch that movie every night for the whole week. So it was in my blood since I was a little kid. But I went to school for architecture. I had two loves. I had entertainment and architecture. When I got out of school, I was a giant MTV fan back in those days.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Where they just showed music videos, and then they had VJs, they had their hosts, and they would show a little behind the scenes and interviews. And I used to think about it, and I was thinking, like, how could I get into the entertainment business, and what could I do? I was trying to option scripts. I was trying to come up with ideas for movies. And I realized that back then, television, cable television in its infancy was just a few channels, but it was more or less like a newspaper where you had headlines and headline news. You had sports and ESPN. You had with the weather and the Weather Channel, stocks and CNBC. But you didn't have that entertainment section of the paper. So I set out to create that entertainment section, and that coupled with a few different things that happened at the same time that gave me the idea for E. I went to a seminar. I was going back and forth to Los Angeles trying to get in the business, and I went to a seminar on how to sell your screenplay to a studio, and they had a whole bunch of studio presidents up speaking. And instead of talking about how to sell your screenplay to a studio, they talked about the high cost of nationally advertising movies. So I sort of sat around all day, and I thought, what could I do to help advertise movies on a national basis? In those days, they would spend $40, $50, $60, $80 million on a movie, and it was just a few ways to advertise that movie. They either relied on a black and white newspaper ad, which was a terrible way to market your movie.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Or
yeah.
They showed trailers in the theater, but that would mean that you would have to be in the theater a couple weeks before your movie came out. Or once in a while, they would have local TV ads, but it wasn't a really good way to do it. So I thought about it, and I said, you know what? Why don't I come up with a 24-hour movie promotion network that would be a lot like MTV. Instead of music videos, we'll show trailers. We'll use the movie's electronic press kits, which they spend $150,000 on kit.
It's crazy.
And they give you an hour of footage and interviews, and use that as behind the scenes and cut in my own hosts. And really, that was the initial thought of E. And in fact, for the first 6 years of E, it was called Movie Time because it was just promoting movies.
Okay.
Then we branched out to television, entertainment, reality shows, everything celebrity. And
Talk
what
Soup.
Went from there.
Love that. Yeah.
Talk Soup was one of our very first shows.
Really?
That we did on E from 1987. Yeah.
Wow. Was Greg Kinnear, was he the first host?
Greg Kinnear was the first host.
Yeah, I remember
and Greg
that.
Greg Kinnear was the first face on E when we went on the air.
Oh,
in
really?
1987.
It's a fresh face, yeah.
Yeah.
That's just, I haven't seen him forever. That's so funny.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, to go from wanting to sell your screenplay to all of a sudden you went from that to now you're creating a network. I mean, how did you go from this small idea, and that's in quotations for people who can't see me, to all of a sudden this huge concept that was greater than what you thought? How did you take, what was the process to go from small to big?
Well, like I said, I was really into MTV, so I was thinking about networks. I knew nothing about starting a network.
Sure.
I went to architecture school.
Oh, really?
That's totally right. It's like going to art school for 5 years. So I knew nothing about starting a business. Yeah. I knew nothing about starting a television network. I had the idea, and I knew somebody that worked at Showtime. And I called him up. I said, what do you think of this idea? I have an idea for a network. You know, the best ideas are always like, you know, wouldn't it be great if someone should have a, you know, and you just come up with these ideas. And everybody has them. Mm-hmm. And I had a bunch even before E. But when I came up with this one, I was like, this is too good. This is like, this has got to be something out there. So I called up a friend of mine. I said, what about helping me do a business plan? He worked at Showtime Marketing. And he put me in touch with Larry Namer, who became my partner and close friend even to this day. Mm-hmm. And Larry had all the experience in the world in the cable business. Larry had been working for Time Inc. Cable, which was before Time mm-hmm. Warner. Mm-hmm. And Larry was a cable executive. He was off on his own, doing his own thing in L.A., coming up with some similar type of concepts. So we got together. We formulated the idea for what we wanted to do. And Larry really knew how to put the business plan together. I knew what I wanted to see on air, but Larry really put it down on paper and actually did a pro forma of how much money we needed to get it started. I love Larry to death, but he couldn't have been more wrong at the time, because we figured that he figured that we needed like around $7 million to get the network going, $6.9 million. And you need like $1 billion to start a network. So we were off by almost $1 billion. I was going to say, but you know, we did the business plan. We put the budget together. And for the next three and a half years, Larry and I set out to just raise the $7 million mm-hmm. to get the thing going.
How was it for you? Because there are obviously highs and lows. So you see this figure that I'm sure was astronomical for you at that time. And you're like, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? How did you keep your momentum going to say, we're going to push through this regardless if that number seems too great or not?
Well, the one thing I kept telling myself, we got rejected a ton of times. I once took a look through all my meetings, and I really think that we got rejected over 400 times.
Oh my god!
That's no baloney. Over 400 times over 3 years. Yeah, and I just kept saying to myself, you know, worse ideas raise more money, mm-hmm. so I can't give up on this idea. And like I always say, I'm a spoiled brat. So the more people that say no, the more people I say to myself, I'm going to show them.
Oh, exactly.
And, and all the rejections fueled me because I knew it was a great idea.
Sure.
And the more times I just got turned down, you know, sent out of an office, walking out dejected, holding my little briefcase, mm-hmm. I was like, I got to get this thing going. I'm not giving up.
Yeah. Do you ever see some of those people now who said no?
And as a matter of fact, I do.
Yeah.
There's a great story. A friend of mine said, you got to meet this Beverly Hills attorney. He raises money. He's got great things going. So I went up myself to see him, and he invited in all of his partners and his whole firm. And I was sort of a little insecure. I was probably 26 at the time. I walked in with my briefcase and I made this presentation to the whole law firm. And after I'm done making this whole presentation, he says, you know what? We're actually doing our own fundraising on something we're doing. And I said to myself, well, why did he bring me in here to hear my pitch if he just wanted to turn me down? And then he told me that, you know, their plan was to launch telecommunication satellites into space. So I left the meeting. I said, you know, this guy turned my idea down, but he wants to compete with NASA. And at the time, that was outrageous. I said, he's never going to get it going. Of course, he never got it going. And I used to see him at the cable conventions after that. And he was all over me. Come on, bring me something. Bring me next idea. And I was like, I said to myself, I will never bring this guy another idea.
Yes.
So that's what happens.
It's funny. I have people like that in my life as well. And it's, you know, obviously we're very cordial. We're very classy. But we also know when we're not going to work with them moving forward.
Right.
When you saw the success of E, how was that for you upon reflection? So let's say as of today, 34 years later, How is that for you to see how far it's come from your dream to today?
Well, I always said when we were starting it that I wanted E to be sort of a matter of fact. Saw it on E, you know, heard it on E, and it became that.
Yeah.
It really has become huge. I've never really sat back and thought about how big it's gotten, but it mm-hmm. is huge. Most broadcasting resumes in Los Angeles have E on it at some point or another. It has started a lot of people. Wow, at any given time, E has 1,000 people working there. So being 30 years old. I mean, I started the network with literally 23 people or 25 people. We had 20 interns and 6 executives. And then it grew to 1,000 people by the time I left. And it's been at least 1,000 people for 30 years.
Wow.
So it's a huge thing. I take pride in all the people's careers I've started. Mm-hmm. And all the young people that have learned at E, which is a great thing. And it's huge. And I see people talking about it. And I'm proud of it. It's my baby that's grown up to be big and famous.
That's amazing. Now, you've done so many other things as well. I know you've worked with like comic books and movies. Tell me more about those ventures.
My creative juices are always mm-hmm. flowing. When I got out of E, I took almost a year off. I played a lot of golf. I thought about what to do next.
Yeah.
It wasn't a great time for me because I don't like doing nothing. But at mm-hmm. the same time, it's very healthy to take a step back.
Yes.
Be proactive and go out and think about your next venture and then go mm-hmm. for it. I always tell people that get fired or leave a job that it's not the end of the world, because in life, a lot of times people's lives are all reactive.
Yes,
they work mm-hmm. and they're just reactive every day. You go in and you do your job, mm-hmm. but it's an opportunity to sit back and do nothing. You know, it's like through this whole COVID crisis, the whole world sort of took a pause and everybody sat around and thought about what to do next. I think I've been I've accomplished more things in the last 8 months than I have in the 5 years before.
That's what you're saying. That's crazy.
So just to answer your question, after I took the year off, I decided I wanted to go in a creative direction. So I started producing movies, television mm-hmm. series. I did a show called, my first show out of the gate was a show called Pacific Blue.
Oh, yeah.
It was about cops on bikes.
It was kind of a lighthearted cop show.
It was the number one show on cable television. It was on USA Network. We did over 100 episodes. It was on for 5 years. I did about a half a dozen movies. And I actually even was trying to start another network, which turned out to be FX, and I sold it to Fox.
Oh, wow. I didn't know you did that one too. Oh, my God.
Yeah, but my FX was a little different. My FX was a fitness and exercise television. That's what the FX were.
Okay, gotcha.
Fox ended up buying it because they wanted the name. They split it into two networks. They did their own network called Fit TV, and they used FX to show their old movies initially. Yeah. So that's how I've gotten into the a creative direction after E, and I've been doing that for a long time.
That's amazing. Now you've transitioned into something else. So you're now in the storage business. Tell us more about that as well, because I thought it was really fascinating to see the transition, but it all is cohesive in your brand. Tell me more about that.
Well, everyone's like, how did you end up in the storage business? I actually ended up in the storage business before I started E in a small way. When I got out of architecture school, I couldn't get a job as an architect. There was a little bit of a recession going on. Uh-huh. And I decided to start renovating small brownstones in Jersey City. Mm-hmm. So as any young developer does, they start with a two-unit, two-family brownstone. Mm-hmm. Then you go to a four-family, then a six-family, then a 10-family. And then I bought a 50,000-square-foot building that I was going to make into like 30 residential units. Yeah. At the same time I was renovating my brownstones in Jersey City, I was trying to get E going. So I was literally going back and forth to Los Angeles. I was doing construction, going back to LA, going back to Jersey City. So it was a roundabout way I got to Hollywood.
Literally.
But when I got that 50,000 square foot building, I left. That's around the same time that I raised only $2.5 million finally to get E going. I took the $2.5 million commitment. I dropped everything in New Jersey. I went to LA, and Larry and I got the network going. But that 50,000 square foot building started to go into foreclosure. I didn't have a lot of money. I didn't have money to carry the building. Two guys here in New York approached me and said, what about if we make this into a self-storage building? I didn't really know much about self-storage. Sure. I was desperate. I'm like, I'm in. So I put the building into the venture. They put their expertise. We put some money in. And it was the first self-storage building. And I was a silent partner in that company for like 15, 20 years.
Wow.
It wasn't until 5 years ago that I pivoted from Los Angeles. I said, you know what? I want to grow this business back in New York. We had a lot of buildings. We finally split up the company. I came back and I started this new brand of self-storage called Storage Blue. Mm-hmm. And it's mainly in New York and New Jersey. What people don't realize when they say, how'd you get in the storage business? You know, what do you think of the storage business? When I started in the storage business 30 years ago, it was a low tech business. If you needed self-storage, you would look in the yellow pages. Most people don't even know what the yellow pages is today.
Yeah, exactly.
But today, self-storage is a high-tech e-commerce business, and that's what I love about it. And I always compare it to, like, if you get a pair of shoes from Amazon, when you get that pair of shoes in the mail, that's a low-tech experience. But if you think about all the high-tech digital that went into you getting that pair of shoes, it's the same thing in the storage business today.
Wow.
If you want self-storage, you'll go to your computer, you'll type in, you know, Palm Beach self-storage, Los Angeles self-storage, whatever pops up. You know, you have to have great search engine optimization or search engine marketing. You have to have a great user experience on the site, and you have to capture the reservation. We then go pick up, we're the first company that then goes and picks up your stuff and brings it back for you. So it's more of a pleasurable experience. I pride myself in disrupting the industry. And then
because nobody likes moving. Nobody likes moving things.
It's the worst customer experience you could possibly have. You have to ask a cousin, a friend, rent a truck, load up the truck. So you go literally online, you order it, you order your moving supplies. We come, we pick up everything, we put it into the storage unit. But the act of getting into that storage unit is the low-tech result of all the high-tech stuff that went into it. Wow. And the beauty and the challenge that I love is the major players in the self-storage industry, like Public Storage, they're worth $40 billion on the stock market.
Oh, my gosh. So, I had no idea.
But the beauty of it is the internet makes it a level playing field.
Sure.
So whoever's better at marketing is going to win that battle and that war. And I'm better than them at marketing.
So, yes, you are.
I take storage and I just look at it like anything else in marketing. Yeah. And I'm creative. I do advertising. We just finished a music video.
I saw that. I just saw that. Yeah,
so
it was great.
We're out there and people are talking about Storage Blue and it's great. And I love it.
That is awesome. Well, you know, I link together the, you know, E! Entertainment Television and other things you've worked on, and then the storage, you're taking one's emotion, you're creating an emotional, visceral experience for the viewer or for the customer. So you're doing the same thing as far as you want a great customer experience, but yet you also want a great viewer experience when it comes to E! So there's that linkage between what you do and how that manifests in every project you're in, which is really amazing.
Right, and the fun part is I started a Storage Blue TV YouTube channel. And I'm doing programming on it. And a lot of people don't realize that Google owns YouTube. Mm-hmm. Google likes when you have video for your search engine optimization. Uh-huh. And I'm putting out there, put videos out there. I did a few songs that we're releasing one at a time that have gone viral. We have on my first music video and song, which is called Too Much Junk, we've had over 3 million views on Instagram in about 10 days.
Oh, my gosh. Wow.
Yeah. So it's amazing. The songs are great. You know,
they are good.
I'm full speed into making the songs great, and it's fun. And it's just, it's all marketing. Marketing is everything in business, no matter what you're selling, you know, whether it's a TV show or self-storage. Yes. And I'm branching out. Storage Blue will be a lifestyle brand. just the same way that Virgin Records became an airlines, became a mobile phone, became everything. So it's just a brand that I've created. I started with self-storage, but we branch out into a lot of different things.
That's exciting. I can't wait to see where this goes.
You know, I always say work gets a bad rap because if you love what you're doing, it's fun.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah. I totally understand that. Like for me, real quickly, I changed my I'm in the same field, but I went from private practice to doing this. And so I've merged all my talents together to create my brand as well. And I absolutely love it. I get to meet wonderful people like you, which has been a blessing. Truly a big blessing.
It's great. And if people ask me what I do, I tell them I'm a brand builder.
Yeah, I like
that. I'm a serial entrepreneur. I'm a brand builder. So it doesn't really, I don't like to get pigeonholed into what specifically, what I'm building, what kind of brand, but I can do anything, you know?
Yeah.
The funny and fun part of Storage Blue is I have storage in the name, but if I didn't have storage in the name, it'd be more palatable to understand that it's building a brand, but then again, you know, it's a little wacky and it's fun and people remember it.
People remember it. Exactly.
Yeah. Right.
Well, Alan Mruvka, it has been an absolute pleasure having you on my show today. If my listeners want to find out more information about you, to learn more about Storage Blue and everything else you're doing, where would they find this information online?
Well, you can go to storageblue.com and see Storage Blue, or you can go to thealancompany.com, which is ALAN, which is my site that encompasses everything, or visit us on YouTube or on Instagram at Storage Blue TV.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for being a wonderful guest on my show. So I truly appreciate all your time.
That's been great. Thanks so much.